I watched a few of your your pieces. I wouldn't call myself a fan, but I enjoy them for sure.
Where did this relationship start?
We fell in love as buddies. It was a strange beginning in that we met as friends. Patrick's girlfriend at the time, it was like 4 or 5 years ago, was our nanny. They first moved to LA looking for jobs. He was just out of film school. And so we would just hang out in my kitchen and friends with my kids, and we became buddies and realized very quickly that we had like a shared sensibility, what we found funny, what we found awkward. We love kind of odd people. We're people watchers. And then I saw Patrick's thesis film, which was a documentary he made while he was in Paris about the owner of the last 35mm projection porn theater in Paris. Interesting personality, all the makings to be a very boring talking head documentary, but this guy was really drawn to Patrick. You could feel the way he was like coming forward to the camera, because Patrick just gave him this very appropriate but very like palpable sense that Patrick really liked him and was interested in him, you know, and there was no judgment there. And I was watching and I was just like, there's something really fascinating about what Patrick is pulling out of this guy. And so, you know, I mean, you know me and what I do. I like working with first-time filmmakers and trying to find something together. And I had this idea a while back about this guy who gets cancer and films himself in a hotel room, and it's just a one-person movie. And I thankfully abandoned it because it was going to be too boring. And then we started talking about, what if, you know, we use that seed of Patrick's personality, which is so great at like being drawn to people, how much he loves people, maybe in the case of Creed, needs people's, you know, affection. And then we took something that's in me that I've kind of struggled with personally. What I'm interested in is like what I call the president of the student council mentality, which is like when I walk into a room, I'm one of the kinds of people who knows how to shift my personality 10-20% to get what I want, or to maneuver a little bit, like, you know, that thing that in an extreme sense is sociopathic, you know. And so we're like, well, let's just blow that up 100% and put it into Joseph, and then put these guys in a room together, and this could be really exciting. So that was really the genesis.
Yeah. And then, I mean, and then taking off of that, I mean, the way that we set about making the movie was like, we didn't have a script. We didn't have, we had a 5-page outline essentially that we were basing the whole thing off of. And,
which was how specific?
Scenes with a little bit of a structure.
Yeah.
Like, Joseph takes Aaron upstairs and says, you know, I want you to film me giving a tub to my unborn son, because maybe he'll never get to see it.
But then once we got to that scene, it was just essentially rolling the camera and Mark going with his performance.
And how much performance was there that we didn't get to see? Are there 20 other improvs that were...
There's a lot of stuff there, I would say. And certain, you know, there's a long history of how this movie was made, because what happened is we set out to make a movie called Peach Fuzz, which we shot in 6 days, and we edited it together. And that represents about 50% of the footage that's in the final film. And that was 3 years ago.
Yeah, and it was meant to be more of like kind of a dark comedy, you know, and kind of a sweet, dark comedy. And
about strange people who kind of find each other.
It was about a connection between these two guys. And then once we started showing that to people, I mean, we showed that to people in its worst iteration, basically its worst, like the rawest form we had. You know, it was kind of just what we were able to put together after our initial production. And then the things that people were responding to were the more the horror or thriller elements to it.
You know, tension.
So
creepy was a response?
Yeah. The response was creepier. And we resisted that a little bit in the same way that, you know, I wanted my daughter to be a tomboy, you know. And so I had designs on what I wanted her to be, but she came out calling for princesses.
Yeah.
And once I let her go get the princesses, everybody got happy.
Yeah.
And once we started to obey what this movie was begging us to do and to be reckless and have fun with it, it got so fun.
Yeah.
And the movies people started really responding to it. So we, you know, it was interesting. Like, we kept going back and shooting scenes and bring them in. And okay, let's keep these two and throw that one away and then go back. Yeah. So we shot for a year and a half, you know.
It was very clinical, you know, like going back and literally doing a whole reshoot where we would just shoot one single moment, you know, in the movie. Just, it was a game of inches where we were, you know, the film was slowly and slowly getting better and better as we moved along.
So was it like Mark has a week here, or Mark, or I have a Patrick has a week here?
There was a little bit of that. I mean, there was times I remember I was shooting The League, and we wanted to get it in time for, we were going to do a real test screening with Blumhouse and see. There was a moment where it looked like we might take this movie out with Universal and 3,000 screens. You know, like, there was, it was very close to being that. And we drove up at 5 in the morning, and we reshot an ending for the third time, which is still not the final one we used, and got in our cars by 8 o'clock so I could be back for a 9:30 call and shoot. You know, it was
completely crazy.
Crazy town, you know. But it was fun, though. I mean, for me personally, like, it had this spirit. I mean, it sounds so corny because I'm only 38, but it had this spirit of, like, being led by a younger generation of filmmakers, with Patrick and our editor Chris Donlan, and like me jumping on to the excitement and the youth of just like holding onto a camera and who gives a shit about lighting, and the way Jay and I were with a puffy chair, you know,
and coming up with an idea and shooting it immediately and then being able to watch it immediately and see if that works or not.
I was like getting my youth back, basically.
38-year-old Dorian Gray.
Yes, yes, it really was, you know. And, you know, if the movie has something to offer, I think in the end, it's part of that vitality, part of that, you know, when you listen to, like, the Yankee Hotel Foxtrot demos and you feel that, like, he's birthing that song while they're recording it. And it's rough-hewn, but it has that spirit to it, you know? Like, that's something I think that is in this movie that I'm really proud of.
So let me go back to the porn in Paris.
Yes.
How did you get to making a documentary about the last porn theater in Paris?
Well, so I went to CalArts, actually. That was where I first moved to L.A.
Okay.
Was to finish up my school at CalArts, and I had written a very...
Did you want to be a straight filmmaker? Were you wanting to do animation,
or
were you
wanting
a documentary filmmaker?
It was so artsy-fartsy.
Yeah. Well, I still am, kind
of,
at the end of the day, but, you know, it was
you're going to make narratives, and you're going to make money.
Right.
It's going to be great.
Mark had different plans for me.
Yeah.
But yeah, so the last 3 months that I was at CalArts, I had written this proposal to go. There was this opportunity came up where you could write a proposal to go make a documentary and study for 3 months at Paris at La Famille, which is the, like, the big French film school there. You know, it's actually very small, but it's, you know, it's like, it's very hard to get into, super competitive.
It's elite.
Yeah, and it was a real culture shock coming from a place like CalArts, which is much more like, you know, all over the place. You're an artist, you tell us what you want to do. Where, you know, in this French film school, where these guys, the school is birthing professionals right out the gate, you know. And so I wrote a proposal about this very, you know, I was going to make a documentary about this composer who had lived in Paris and done work there. It was very dry. It was going to be a very dry kind of talking head documentary. And I got the scholarship based on this proposal. And then I got to Paris, and I'm completely by myself, and I'm thinking about this movie, and I'm like, you know what? I don't want to do this. So I started doing research and came up across this theater, this porn theater, in the Bonne Nouvelle district. I think it might be the last porn theater in the world that still only plays 35 millimeter film. And it's this guy that's running it who's losing money, but he's doing it because he loves it, and he's doing it because he there's this connection to it. Like, it is, it defines
there's
him.
There's gotta be a small audience member, considering how some people really love 35 millimeter film, that can only come if it's on 35 millimeter.
Yeah,
you know, that it has to be.
No, I met him. Yeah, they were there. There's these old guys that come and they drink coffee. I mean, if I had more time, I would. There's a whole culture surrounding this. It's actually, like, very sweet. You know, it's a lot of guys who, like, you know, went through the horrors of World War II and, like, don't know how to use a computer. And this is their access to that. You know, so I don't know. Like, once again, I have sympathy for that kind of situation. Yeah.
Well, thanks to Fred Willard, I actually know some things about this.
Yeah, weirdly
enough, because I looked into it, and it turns out there's a porn theaters, a 35 35mm porn theater would be illegal in New York point. However, in like Great Neck, there's a old porn theater where they put booths on the sides of the alleys of the theater.
So it makes it...
So it makes it like you're going to a theater, even though they don't actually project to the big screen anymore.
Right. Well, even that's probably... they're probably showing DVDs there, too. Yeah.
No, they're definitely not showing 35mm film. That's, they threw all that out.
Yeah. And so... You know, so I just said, fuck it. You know, I'm by myself. This is something that I was looking at it, you know, honestly from like an ethnographic standpoint of like, this place is not going to exist in 5 years. This is a chance to document something.
That's why I'm doing this interview. By the way.
Yeah, exactly. Right, we're going down.
Right. After we're dead,
get the final Duplass interview.
Yeah. But yeah, and so it was just, you know, it was a chance, and that was also my explanation to my wife, who was very angry that I was going to be making this documentary now. But it was great, because for me, it was the first real time I'd collaborated with other people. You know, I didn't make any narrative work in school. Mm-hmm. I was mostly just watching a lot of films and writing papers about film theory and stuff. And so it was really great to be in a foreign country and to kind of, like, you know, to go up in front of the class and say, guys, I'm going to go make this movie about this porn theater. Who wants to do this with me? And all of a sudden, I had five really amazing, insanely capable film students working, you know, as my crew, essentially, as my translator, my DP, my sound person, my editor, you know, all working with me on this thing. And it was hugely validating to be able to do that and then, you know, like, come home, like, from the hunt, like, with some meat, you know, and then come back and I showed the film to Mark, and he loved it, and was sort of the genesis of us, like, deciding to make something else together.
So you seem to be in the kind of universe that Mark has been in for a while of kind of a gathering of like-minded people. I mean, certainly with the overnight also, everybody kind of seems to, it also seems to, like, let's put on a show kind of feel to it. Is that what that universe is that what that group is like for you all at this point?
It feels that way. Yeah. And I feel insanely just, like, I don't know what the word is, but, like, blessed. I feel like, you know, like, every day. I don't, you know, normally your bosses are people that you're, you know, you come at odds with, and they're not people you think, like, you know, like, my producers are Mark, my producers are Adam and Naomi, you know, these people who I share a sensibility with, I share a sense of humor with, and also, like, respect me as a filmmaker. So it's like, it's, for me, it's the best case scenario.
We share weed with us too. I
mean, and we smoke a lot of weed.
That's important.
You know, it's everything. But I also know that, like, that's not always going to be the case as well. I'm well aware of that. And so I feel very lucky to have had this experience so far with these, you know, collaborators who are also my bosses, who are also my best friends.
You know? Well, are you ambitious? Do you have the urge to go off and make, you know, $80 million movies and things?
Yeah, I mean, I just want to keep making work. That's all that matters to me right now. You know, if that opportunity presented itself, depending on the project, yeah. But
Jurassic World 2, or
that's not
which you were really good in, Mark, by the way.
Thank you.
You and Aubrey both were tremendous in that film. Did you feel left out
For Jurassic World?
Yeah.
No, not at all whatsoever.
You didn't want to be handling the dinosaurs yourself?
No, I don't know. I have less of the aspiration to, like, head up, like, a huge franchise. I've kind of watched what's happened with Chris Pratt a little bit. And by the way, nobody should ever feel sorry for Chris Pratt. It's great. But, like, the little I've experienced with diminishing privacy, like, when I'm in a movie like Tammy that comes out on 3,000 screens, like, mm-hmm. those 2 weeks, like, it really freaks me out, genuinely, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, being around my kids and people come up and not being able to escape that to a certain degree. And even, like, Togetherness has really increased my profile quite a bit. I mean, it's amazing how many eyes get on those HBO shows in the long run.
And some angry women.
Yeah, and some angry women.
My wife is kind of pissed off at you still.
At me?
Yeah. Well, your character, at least.
It's understandable.
That ending was very upsetting to her.
It goes both ways.
I mean, and, like, one other thing that I think it has to do with...
Oh, you're right, actually. Yeah. Sorry.
Yeah. I was gonna say, I think it has to do with freedom. You know, like a lot of these choices have to do with freedom, and like the freedom that becomes more and more diminished once you're beholden to money or studios or people. You know,
yeah.
And so it becomes this thing where you're reconciling the material and your ability to contribute to it and make something that's truly great, and then also, you know, make something you believe in and love. Essentially, like, I just want to keep making work that I love.
You have high class problems right now, which is interesting, and this is a very specific thing, so I won't spend too much time on it, but like, most of the times when you're making an independent film, you have gotten some acclaim, but you have made zero money, so you are forced to take the next job, and you are not in a position to waffle too much about whether creatively it's the perfect fit for you or not. You're fucking broke, and somebody's going to give you a job, and you take it. The way we've structured these movies with Creep and the Overnight, and we've talked a lot about this in the past with the ownership and how things. Mm. Patrick can make a very healthy living if he stays right here in this spot and continue to make, and he can then take the money he's making off of these and invest in his own movies. So there is a future for him that is like right here, you know, and doesn't even deal with agents and offers, you know, and he won't say this, but he is getting those offers. Like, they, when you watch The Overnight, you see like, oh, he can handle a comedy with four movie stars that plays to big laughs, has some heart, is essentially very mainstream in a lot of ways, you know. So you have a lot of with dicks, yeah, you got that going on. But you have a lot. You're gonna have a harder choice in a lot of ways to, like, it's not all or nothing for you to go and make more of a studio film. You know, you're gonna be like, maybe I should stay small. You know.
And, so you and Jay, it seems, have really made that choice.
I was gonna say, look at the model that I've been working with.
So, yeah.
I'm working with your guys' model essentially.
Essentially. So, there's other steps. There's like, togetherness is another step where it's like, I'm salaried. I'm not paying for togetherness. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm salaried. I'm taken care of by my big papa, HBO. But I'm also, you know, able to make exactly what I want to make. It kind of took me 10 years to get to that point to be able to like have my cake and eat it too, which is what I am getting to do with togetherness.
And your ongoing deal you guys just did sounds like a similar kind of, like, that's an opportunity to do what you want to do.
Yeah, I mean, Jay and I, just for lack of a better word, over the past year have sort of like, if you look at our business as like a startup, you know, that's held on to its own value, we've just sort of sold some of our shares a little bit so that we can like have some comfort and know that like we could buy our houses now and do what we need to do, but still maintain what we want to do. And we were lucky that like the selling out that we got to do with HBO and Netflix happens to be with just two massive corporations who, you know, I mean, speaking candidly, honestly, like, the way that they look at us is not money makers. They look at us as something that builds their brand and shows that they are like, I'm making a bunch of Adam Sandler movies, but I'm also making Duplass Brothers movies. Mm-hmm. I'm making Game of Thrones, but I'm also making Togetherness, you know? And what that means is that as long as we're doing what we're doing, we get to do kind of whatever we want, you know? Mm-hmm. And that is so unique right now. Like, I am so thankful for IFC and Magnolia and all these companies that brought me up, but it can be a struggle at times because they're struggling for cash and we're struggling for cash and we get afraid and we don't often market the movies the way we should because we get scared and we want to make the movies. Mm-hmm. Netflix and HBO and Amazon, they don't give a fuck. They're rich as shit and we are a little lottery ticket.
Yeah.
It's awesome. Like, it's really cool.
Speaking of which, is what is the deal with The Orchard? Is it?
They're the greatest company. They're the greatest company. Okay, because here's The Orchard. Here's The Orchard in a nutshell. Like, they went and got all of the smartest 26 to 34 year old people at all the companies and promoted all of them to senior positions.
Yeah.
The people who had the skills but had a ceiling on them. And then they were luckily funded by a successful music organization. It's essentially parent company.
Mm-hmm.
So they had funds to go in and they were like, we're going to go in and we're going to get one huge movie out of Sundance. And I mean, it was interesting selling the movie to The Orchard at Sundance because, you know, everybody was like, are we doing this? Like, we have
a huge unknown.
Much more reputable companies bidding on this movie. We had the searchlights and everybody circling and stuff like that. But our gut was like, these guys are so passionate. We're their horse, so they have to hitch themselves to us. They will not let us go down, you know? Mm-hmm. And even while we were selling them, we're like, what are we doing? They're totally unproven. Are we doing this? Okay, here we go. You know, and they've just turned out to be the best.
And with all these companies that have started up in the last couple of years, they actually did release the movie in a real way, and they're pushing it,
and it's working.
Know, yeah,
you know.
And that was their main selling point was we believe in a real theatrical life for this movie.
Yeah,
you know, and in a smart way too, not in a way that they were just going to dump it on 1,000 theaters. Mm-hmm. You know, just on the get go and watch it fail. I mean, it was really.
That's a bummer what happened to Dope. You know, it's like it really just not going to
hit. Well, and the D-Train, too. You know?
Yeah, the D-Train, that was terrible.
It's just,
But ironically, Dope is doing good business for that company.
It's doing pretty well for the company, but the movie, unfortunately, is going to come and go pretty quickly, and it should have had that life to grow, in my opinion. I mean, what do I know? I'm not a distributor, but, you know, we know. I feel it was right for the overnight to give it its time to grow, and it's working.
Yeah. Well, it's really hard out there, I think, for everybody. I mean, I think there are a lot of companies trying. Searchlight's having their own struggles with
Everybody's struggling in the middle.
Me and Earl, you know, it's like, well, they're doing, I mean, they've obviously won the Oscar the last couple of years and had some big successes, but they've also, you know, me and Earl was the hot thing.
Yeah,
and
right. It hasn't quite
probably not going to do what they paid for it.
No, not even close.
So
it won't. And that, you know, that kind of brings us to talking about a movie like Creep, which is like, we're crowded in the middle of summer. We decided we wanted to release this movie in tandem with the overnight to show the world, to bring Patrick into the world and get him to pop so those movies could help each other out, you know. And we made a very deliberate, conscious decision. Part of it was part and parcel with my deal with Netflix. But it was like, okay, how important is it to us that Creep gets seen in the movie theater, you know? And should, let's just be honest as consumers, when Jurassic World and Inside Out and Mad Max and Magic Mike come out, should we be asking people to pay $12 to see Creep instead of those movies? Mm-hmm. And the resounding answer was no. You know, and we really felt confident that, like, this new model we have, which is you get 3 weeks on iTunes for my dedicated fans of the overnight, the Blumhouse fans who love that movie and want to come, small group, they're going to come to go see it there, and that's going to be great. And then there's this whole slew of people in this country and internationally who, like, kind of know who we are but aren't sure, that is perfect for a free click on Netflix.
Yeah.
And this whole concept of going worldwide day and date with a movie like Creep, where internationally our movies just don't do a lot of business, you know, but there's awareness there. And so while the international promotion can go out at the same time day and date, it's like, that seems really right. It seems like a tiny little movie that we made that I think it came out better than it should have, you know? But like,
we certainly tried long enough.
Yeah, we tried long enough. We tried really fucking hard.
Yeah.
Like, it seems right that, like, the bulk of the people to see that movie should be like, I kind of heard about this. This is interesting. Let me click on it, you know? That's, in a lot of ways, a lot of my movies have become successful like that. Even Safety Net Guaranteed became what it became through Netflix. Yeah.
So is it a changing experiment each time? Or will you take a lesson from this and then go to figure it out differently the next time?
It's a changing experiment each time. I mean, I'm going to make 4 original Netflix movies, you know, and depending on how those come out, we're going to decide whether they should have a theatrical, whether they should not. You know, I brought in Orchard as a partner there because they're buddies and they're good and we can shuck and jive with them. And so we can say, you know, holy shit, this movie is really clicking and we see a window here where this could go in the theaters. Let's go for it, you know, and let's give it a shot. In particular, Patrick is a first-time filmmaker. It felt very important to us that the overnight get out there to do for his career what we felt like it could in that theatrical space, you know? If Barry Levinson comes to me and is like, I just want to make a renegade little movie, he doesn't really need a theatrical release to, like, make his career, you know? Like, we could say, we made a little niche movie. Let's go rake it in on VOD and let people see it on Netflix. And that's kind of cool to me, you know? And I think, like, I don't know. Maybe it's because I've been around for... I keep talking about how old I am. I don't know why I'm doing this. I've been around so long, you know.
But you know what? In the real,
in the realm, I've made like 30 movies, you know?
And you've been through the transition to digital.
Yeah, so like I don't need a theatrical release to make my career anymore. And I think when you get to that point, you can be honest about what the movie deserves and how it should be seen without feeling ashamed.
Yeah.
Well, it's kind of pushing. Oh, sorry.
I was just going to say, like, the movie just opening up on VOD or just, you know, it means a different thing than when a film would go direct to video nowadays.
Yeah.
You know? It's just, it is the Wild West, you know?
Well, it's kind of pushing back from the other direction now, it feels like, when you have, you know, HBO now kind of experimenting with releases and probably losing money on not having a wider release for Cobain. And,
absolutely.
You know, Amy is coming out in from A24. It's been interesting what the numbers on that are.
Yep. Yeah.
But there's a lot of niche markets that have a lot of money. I mean, you look at the numbers every week, and there's huge Indian sales. Yeah. Quebecois movies do a lot of business compared to a lot of small indies.
Christian.
Well, and as you get Christian to market. Subscription-based viewing, there's an unquantifiable value of exclusivity to what you're offering too, you know, and that's part of what I've discovered with Netflix is, you know, I have such a healthy partnership with these guys because they're paying us really, really well to make these movies that independent film, quite frankly, can't afford. The numbers don't make sense in a lot of ways, but for their brand and for the exclusivity they offer, it actually does make sense to them because it's a drop in the bucket for who they are as a global brand.
Right.
So we are like the perfect fit in many ways. Yeah. Like they're paying us a pittance, which is a fortune to us, you know, and it's like everybody's winning.
Well, they pay over retail, which is nice.
Yeah.
For everybody. Whether they're paying for giant things or for indie things.
That's exactly it.
They're kind of willing to pay over retail still.
Yeah.
Thank God for the moment.
Thank God.
Thank God you got your deal done.
That's why, like,
I don't know. But
I don't mean to be fussy, but when I keep hearing, like, conferences, like the death of independent film and stuff, I'm just like, guys, there's a lot of great stuff going on here right now, you know?
What's scary, I think, people look at the numbers, you know, the VOD kind of has turned out to have a ceiling, a glass ceiling.
Absolutely.
And people are kind of still struggling with the idea that that's real and not going to change.
Yeah.
And then you have IFC and Magnolia experimenting with regular releases now, unlike they used to.
I know.
So everybody's trying to find, you know,
ways
how to get to $8 million, how to get to $14 million, and it's challenging.
But clinging to old models is never going to work when it comes to that stuff.
Except that if you're putting on theatrical, the marketing costs are so large that people have to, it's scary. You know, you can knock out one of these companies.
But even with that, like the way the Orchard has been handling the overnight, you know, they're not buying billboards. You know, they're making extremely pointed buys, you know, like going to like a Comedy Central and saying, we're going to have the trailer play in Comedy Central because that's, you know, like likely those people are going to be the type of people that would come watch this movie in the theater, you know. Like spending the money, but spending it in a smart way, you know, in a more direct way.
Is there a togetherness billboard up there somewhere?
Yeah, there was a ton of them at the beginning of season one.
Well, but I meant for the Emmy season. We've been seeing so many Emmy billboards this last couple weeks.
There's one in Los Feliz, and I think they put it there because they know we live there, just to make sure we felt good.
Yeah.
There's not a huge Emmy's push for togetherness necessarily, and you know, I think that HBO has a lot of shows that have more awards potential in their mind, you know. In my brain, it's really new to me, and I don't really understand how Emmy nominations work, and so I'm gonna kind of like lay back and try not to get my feelings hurt this year if it doesn't happen, and then just like I did with the film industry, like try to figure it out, you know. And it took me about 3 or 4 years to get my feet on the ground after I made the puffy chair, and I was like, oh, this is how I can maneuver, you know. And I'm kind of starting to figure that out in the TV space. Us making Animals independently and taking that to HBO was a really exciting thing. I'm excited to do more of that, you know. Award stuff, I don't know, I've never had that much luck with awards stuff. So
I don't know that anybody actually knows the answer to the Emmy season. I think it's kind of like once it sticks forever for some reason.
I really want it. And I don't want to admit that I want it because it's kind of gross, but like I don't want to get attached to it because I know I'll be disappointed. Yeah. So I'm just kind of like, I'm just not going to talk about it. You know?
Yeah. Well, the writing is pretty sensational at the very least.
Oh, thank you.
Much less all the fine performances.
Thank you, sir.
And of course, the nudity, because that's a recurring theme of all Duplass films.
Absolutely.
Too, baby.
Did you ask for a prosthetic for this movie? Or since
I really just went for it. I have no fear of the nudity. You're going to see some excellent stuff in season two. Togetherness, I can assure you.
Why meant for Creep?
Did you for Creep? No. Someone did ask me if that was a Merkin. and I said, nope. That's how the Lord made me.
Oddly, Jason had no urge to talk about the prosthetic. Adam really wanted to talk about the prosthetic.
Well, by the way, when you wear the big prosthetic, you just keep your mouth shut and just let everybody imagine what it is. That's what you do.
So
when you're the little one, you have to talk.
Yeah.
So is that material... Is it a different feeling having made a movie like that than having made Creep?
No, they're both such specific experiences. You know, Creep was this, like, you know, like I said, this is crazy, like, amorphous 2-year thing where it was the development process essentially as the production of the film. You know, we didn't have a script going into it, we just had an outline and made it. And then with the overnight, it was great to be able to take all the stuff that I learned making Creep, you know, kind of the hard way, you know, the biggest one being when you're making a movie, when you're directing a movie, you're essentially just solving problems all day long. That's your job, is solving problems. And a lot of the time, you're solving problems that you created for yourself when you were sitting by yourself, you know, writing your script with your dog sleeping at your feet, you know, without a care in the world. All of a sudden, you're on a set and you're, you know, you're beholden to all these people around you and having to, you know, deal with all this shit that you created for yourself. And so, but I don't know, at the same time, like, I approach every project like this as a collaboration, and I'm, you know, for me to go from having no tools to having some tools was great, because then I respected and treated each new tool as its own special thing. Like, I was able to have a gaffer who I could have conversations with about lighting, and, you know, I was able to have my own DP who was doing that job. It was, you know, having the experience of Creep, you know, was great, because I was stressed out a lot of the time. Like, I was stressed out having to act, and like also just us having to sort of create this film out of nothing. You know, that's like scary. That's a scary experience.
It's like you learned how to surf on a 20 foot piece of wood.
Yeah.
And then somebody handed you like an 8-foot board.
Yeah. It's like, oh, okay.
Now you're ready for that 6-foot shredder.
Yeah,
now you're
exactly.
ready to just tear it up.
And do you, in jumping from thing to thing, have that same feeling? I mean, didn't you guys do Tangerine as well?
Yeah, I'm. You know,
which is all iPhone.
Yeah, I'm
such a great movie.
I'm at my best. You know, inherently, I shouldn't say my best. I'm at my happiest when I feel scrappy and when I feel like I am having limited materials and doing the best that I can with them. You know, even when I was in my musician phase of life, I was always happier making the demos than I was trying to perfect the actual recording. You know, and so I think that's why I've ended up becoming such a like an active producer. It's like I realize I'm very good at getting things up to like 80% very quickly. I'm actually not so great at closing them out. Jay is fantastic at that, and that's why we work together. You know, So, like, I'm really enjoying my ability to, like, see the DNA of the overnight, what that could be for Patrick, to build it, get that thing up on its feet, give him the relationships to get the cast, give him some money. I can do that in, like, 3 days, you know, just, like, whoosh, get it together. And then I kind of stall out, and I need somebody to kind of, you know, have the precision to get it through.
And that's Jay.
That's Jay, or Patrick, or Charlie McDowell, with the one I love, or Lynn Shelton, or all these people, you know. And I work best that way.
And does it feel like a family? I mean, it's interesting, because I've had this conversation with Judd Apatow, who has all these people around him.
Yeah.
He doesn't feel like he has a cult.
Yeah.
You know, and then there's the Duplass cult, which...
I mean, we hang out, you know, like a lot of us, and not everybody, but, you know, tonight we'll be gathering at my home to watch The Bachelorette, and that group of and that group of 10 people, there will be, like, 4 or 5 filmmakers and a couple of actors and a DP, and all of us have worked together, and so, and on that level, there is a very much a community family aspect to it.
It feels very like natural and fluid, though.
Yeah.
You know, it's not something like we like question or think about necessarily.
Yeah.
It's just these are.
Yeah, it's not like get it together.
Yeah.
You know? And every now and then there will be jealousies when someone's movie kicks ass more than the other's movie, and there will be hard stuff as there is in every family, you know. But it's worth it, I think.
And if you guys decide to make a movie tonight, you'll just pull out your camera.
We're too fucking tired. We're both exhausted. I just wrapped together on Thursday. He's been on a press tour forever. Yeah. But still, as tired as we are, at lunch we were even talking about Creep 2, so we can't stop ourselves. Yeah. So.
Excellent. Thank you, guys.
All right, DP.
So much,
appreciate it. Always a pleasure, man.
Indeed.
Thank you.